Hi, my name is Vee, and if you're new to my channel, hi. I make videos about lifestyle and architecture since I'm an architecture student. I really like giving advice about what I do, and I hope I can help you out with different things. So please subscribe down below if you like my video. Anyways, today's video is going to be very useful, I think, because it's gonna be about how to make great site analysis for a project, because I feel like having a good site analysis can actually make your project so much better, because we all have to keep in mind the historical and geographical and any kind of context really when building something somewhere. So without further ado, let's get right into this video. Now, a little disclaimer, I'm going to show some of my drawings for my current project at school, but this is a team project, so we are a team of five, so of course I give credits to all of my colleagues for every board and every drawing, because not all of them are done by me, but I will write specifically for each drawing which one was done by me, and I will link my my colleagues' names down below. This is a disclaimer. Okay, so the first step towards having a great site analysis is actually going to the site. So whenever you receive the brief, you are actually given the address of the site where your project is going to be located. So if possible, just go there, go around your site and explore and see how you feel over there. See how the atmosphere is. See if it's crowded, if it's not crowded, if it's noisy, if it's quiet, if there's a lot of people living there, or if it's more of a commercial part of the city. See how it relates to other landmarks within the city. Just go there and explore, because this is the best way to get to understand the site initially, by actually going there, exploring, and getting a sense of the atmosphere there. Of course, that's not always possible, since sometimes we have to build some projects on sites that are not accessible to us, especially now in the pandemic, but you can actually use Google Earth or Google Maps to go on Street View and just walk around the site. Even though it's not like the real thing, it's still pretty good and can still give you an idea about how the overall site looks like. The second step towards having a great site analysis is actually documenting all of the surroundings. And by documenting, I mean actually having the 2D drawings of everything and the 3D model of the surroundings. I mean, that's hard to do on your own sometimes, because sometimes your site can be really big. What we do as a studio, we actually divide the site in, I don't know, 6 to 10 parts, and we just make themes, and each theme documents a certain part of the site, which is very useful, because this way we can have a huge 3D model of the whole area and a huge plan and a huge like elevation of the streets and stuff like that for the whole studio. So it's really convenient because we can all further do our analysis on those drawings. But if you can't have that, of course there are a lot of websites that help you with 2D plans of different cities. I will link some down below. And yeah, you can do that yourself as well if you feel like it, and try to document as much of the surroundings as you possibly can. You don't have to spend so much time on it, so just do it in the first days, because this way you're going to have your base for the analysis and you're gonna have the material to draw things on, if it makes sense. A third step, in my opinion, is to just look into the history of the site. History is really, really important, since you have to know what was on the site before your intervention, and you have to know everything about the history. Try to find books, articles, everything you can find on the internet, photos. It's really important to know and understand the site really well. For example, now we have this project in which we have to do an urban intervention somewhere in the center of the city of Bucharest. And we have to make an intervention around this very important road here called Calea Moșilor. And this is actually, this was actually a really important route in the past, because it used to lead to this really important fair that does not exist anymore. But I just thought it was really interesting how that this road has such an important meaning for the city, and this fair was actually a symbol of Bucharest back then, and I didn't even know it existed. Like, there is nothing that indicates the existence of any fair, of any such road now. There's no evidence. So I feel like understanding the history of the site can actually help you so much when actually getting to design your project, because you'll know what to look for and what's missing from the site. Now, the next step would be actually interpreting the information that you gathered so far and getting to do some boards, some drawings, and yeah, just interpret the information. So how we usually start the site analysis is usually by finding a good cover. For example, you can just go to the site and do some sketches or actually some watercolor paintings and stuff like that. For example, we found some really beautiful watercolor paintings from a person that actually used to go to that fair that I was talking about all the time and assist, and actually it really illustrates well how life used to be back then and what the atmosphere of the fair was like in general. So we decided to include that on the cover because it said a lot about what our project was going to be about and about the site in general. Next, I would suggest having a very high level, big scale plan of the city of your project, because that will help people who see your project identify exactly where the site of your project is in the city and in relation to other landmarks from the city. Which brings me to the next point of, first of all, finding multiple maps of the city, historical maps, and try to illustrate and portray the evolution of the city, because of course a city evolves a lot over time, and I feel like this is really important in order to see how the urban tissue around the site where you're going to build your project looked like in the past and how it looks like now, and to see what kind of transformations it went under, so you understand better what kind of transformation you can further do to the urban tissue, you know. But also try to identify some special landmarks, both historical and present landmarks, because those are really important and those are points of interest in that area, and you really need to keep those in mind when you come up with a concept. But landmarks can be of two types. The first type is a landmark in the city, so maybe it's in your area, but that landmark is important for the whole city and people from everywhere within the city can come to that landmark and see it, like a very important museum or a monument or something like that. But of course, the landmarks can be local as well and just related to the small area that your project is going to be built in. For example, like a church, a school, and stuff like that. So keep that in mind and try to differentiate the two of them a little bit at least. Another point that I would suggest to be highlighted in the analysis would be the streets, because of course you need to understand exactly how the people get around. And yeah, that can be by car, by bus, pedestrian, sidewalks and stuff like that. So you need to see if there's a lot of traffic, if there's not much traffic, so you need to identify these aspects as well. Of course, there are some other aspects that you have to highlight. For example, the urban transformation and the urban tissue, as I mentioned earlier, to understand what kind of tissue there is there, if it's dense, if it's scarce, if it's specific to an urban area, to the urban center, to the urban periphery. There's a lot to take into consideration, so you need to analyze the site really well and understand all the changes that it's been through. And moving on from the urban tissue to actual buildings that are on that tissue, you need to also analyze the buildings that are present there to see, for example, their functions and understand if your site is located to many shops, for example, or it's next to a school or something like that, because of course that can influence a lot your proposal. But also the architectural styles that are prevalent in a certain area, because that's also important and you need to keep that in mind, because that area can be protected, of course, all the rules and regulations of the area as well. For example, you also need to keep in mind the height and the cornice height that is permitted over there, and different regulations that are specific to any area, so you need to keep those in mind when coming up with a proposal, because those are really important. And don't forget the buildings with architectural value, because those will always be a point of interest within a city, and of course your project can relate to those as well. Another thing to keep in mind is vegetation and how green an area is, because your project can actually make an area greener or less green, or I don't know, it can relate to this so much. This is a very important aspect when designing something that also aims to be sustainable in a way, because you need to understand the problems of the area in order to design the specific proposal that solves some of the problems in the area. I think I already mentioned to follow the urban regulations and to see what street alignment there is on the streets nearby your site, to understand if your house has to be on the street alignment and it has to be aligned to the other houses nearby or the other buildings nearby, because you can't really do something that is one of a kind over there, so you need to take that into consideration. If it's withdrawn from the alignment of the street, you need to keep that in mind. Of course, you need to really see all these aspects and how the buildings near your site relate to the street and relate to the city in general. Of course, you also have to keep in mind the access and how you actually get to enter a space, if you enter a building through a yard, or if you enter directly from the street, or if you have these small intermediary spaces that you need to keep in mind, because there are so many in Bucharest, there are so many, and you need to really keep those in mind and try to do something similar, because you want to propose something that really fits within a certain urban tissue but is something new but still has to fit in within the historical context. So this is a challenge, and I feel like this is the biggest challenge that you have to meet. And some other aspects that you have to take into consideration when it comes to the site analysis are the details, because finding some details from different buildings can actually be really interesting, because those can inspire you for your further proposal. Of course, you can make some drawings with photographs or sketches from the site that you made yourself, and yeah, show all of the beautiful 2D drawings that you made, and also try to make these elevations with pictures from the site, or just try to really get really in depth with that analysis, because it really helps, and I promise that it can guide you so much when it comes to finding a proposal, because yeah, it's important. If you don't know anything about a site, you're not gonna know how to make an intervention there and what is suitable for the place, and your architecture will turn out something that is hated by the people around, because you just didn't take into consideration everything that there is there, because good architecture is architecture that is sensible to its context. And now, last but not least, I'm going to give you some tips, some final tips for you, because I feel like these are things to be said, and I really want to tell you guys right now. The first of all is to use very different and various representation media, so you don't have to just limit yourself to 2D drawings or 3D models, of course that, but also 3D sections, screenshots from Google Earth, represented in different ways, sketches, watercolor paintings, anything that you like, of course photographs, colleges, like everything, because I feel like diversity is really appreciated. My second tip is to actually keep a color palette, and this is very important and something that I didn't used to do. I used to do all of my drawings black and white, but I feel like having some colors here and there can actually really make your drawings and your boards and your visuals more appealing in general, because who doesn't love some color, right? And by having a cool color palette, and you can actually look up on Pinterest or on the internet, yeah, it would make your drawings look so much better. For you guys who are working in teams, having a common template, for example, a Photoshop template, if you do your drawings in Photoshop, well, that is gonna be really good, because having a template is just gonna assure that all of the drawings are going to be unitary and everybody is going to have beautiful, well-aligned drawings with respecting the same color palette and respecting the same line widths and the same positioning, the same alignment. It's just way better, so I just recommend you do that. Tip number four is actually to draw a logical conclusions out of your site analysis. I mean, of course, that's pretty obvious, but I still wanted to mention it, because in my previous years, I didn't used to do that really. And I just used to do this analysis because we had to, and then I just didn't use it enough. So you have to use it and actually do it in order to support your ideas, and just use it as a demonstration for your ideas. So if you have some ideas, try to find some information that backs it up and put it on the drawing and really show it to your tutors or to your clients. And yeah, I feel like this is gonna be super helpful for actually clarifying things in your mind as well. So basically, this leads us to the end of this video. I just want to say thank you guys so much for watching this, and I'm really excited because this is the first time I actually show some of my work, which is amazing and fun. I just want to say that for those of you who are curious about what we actually have to do for studio and about our brief, you can actually go down below and look over it and tell me in the comments what you find interesting about it or any ideas that you think are interesting, because now you've seen the site analysis and you can follow it. Even though it's in Romanian, I think you can follow it pretty easily because we try to tell our stories with images and drawings, not with words. So mostly I think you understand it. And yeah, I really hope that this was helpful for you guys, and let me know if you have any ideas for my project or for any other project really, and if you have any comments on whatever I just showed here. Thank you so much for watching, and see you in my next video, which is going to be also exciting. Bye! All my friends keep saying that I'm way too good to you.